Exciting news, everybody. Just a couple of days ago, I solved the 40 Rubik's cube for the first time. Not many people have done this. So I thought I'd do a video on this to enable as many of you as possible to do the same. I've got two warm-up exercises for you. The first one is this. What are you looking at here? Strange question. Obviously a cube, but that's not the correct answer. What you're looking at is a 2D image of a three-dimensional cube. It's going to be very important, this kind of distinction. Second thing. So imagine a cube, which has a kind of a solid surface. How many faces can you see max when you kind of look at it? And most people will answer 3, which is wrong. If you actually imagine that the cube is hollow and you can step inside, what you see is 5 faces. And actually you can even see 6 faces. If you go into one of the corners and kind of just look around, you can see all 6 faces of the cube. Kind of thinking inside the box. Now, this actually is a view of a Rubik's cube simulator. So the Rubik's cube simulator actually shows you the cube like this. So it's a lot better than what you see normally when you look at something like this holding in your hand. Here's a couple of twists. There. And now that one is actually when you turn the Rubik's cube. And that gets us straight away to our 40 Rubik's cube. So there it is. Comes in the form of a program. It's called Magic Cube 4D. So you download this for free off the web. It's a program that has been around for a long time, has been developed for a long time. It's a great program. You should use it. And this is the 40 Rubik's cube. Well, no, it's not the 40 Rubik's cube. What it is, well, something similar to that, right? Wherever you see squares there, you see cubes here. Now, this one is a two-dimensional image of a three-dimensional object. Now, the four-dimensional Rubik's cube actually really exists in abstract four-dimensional mathematical space, but of course we can't really go there, right? So what we have to do is we have to project it down to three dimensions, just like we projected our three-dimensional object to this two-dimensional surface. So we can do the same sort of thing. This guy here, for example, you can think of it as 6 square faces that are glued together at the edges. This one here in actual four-dimensional space is 8 cubes glued together along the faces of the cubes. And here, well, you see 5 and one's missing. And here you see 7 of the 8 cubes and one's not visible here. Anyway, so what this really is, well, what is it really? It's a two-dimensional image of a three-dimensional image of a four-dimensional Rubik's cube. You can manipulate like a real object. In fact, you don't even have to know that it's a four-dimensional Rubik's cube, you can just take the program and just manipulate it based on what you see there. Okay, that's what we want to do. Okay, let's have a look here. That's some twists. You can see it's a lot more complicated than a normal Rubik's cube. That's actually turns of the Rubik's cube, so we don't manipulate anything. We kind of just turn it around to look at it from different perspectives. Okay, and this is what it looks like solved. If you want to actually be one of those people who can solve it, you first have to scramble it. Scrambled, it looks like that. Pretty intimidating. First time you see this, you think, nah, this is just a mess. Right? I don't want to touch this. But you probably thought the same the first time you saw like a 5 by 5 by 5. And you know, think, you know, I don't want to touch this one. But of course, then you realize, well, actually, since I know how to do the 3 by 3 by 3, the normal Rubik's cube, well, I can actually solve this part of the 5 by 5 by 5, so I'm always halfway there. And something similar is the case with the 40 Rubik's cube. So with the 40 Rubik's cube, at first sight at least, there is no Rubik's cube inside. You see lots of these cubes, but they all have the same color. So where are the Rubik's cubes? Well, I'll show you in a second. Now let's have a close look at the individual bits and pieces that are being manipulated here. So in a normal Rubik's cube, you've got 3 different types of cubies that are being manipulated around. So there's first the face cubies. They just have 1 sticker. So we also got something like this here in the 40 Rubik's cubes. It's the little cubicle stickers right in the center of these cubicle cells. So there's one kind of a hypercubie. Now we've got cubies that have 2 stickers. We also have cubies that have 2 stickers in the four-dimensional cube. Here, it's edge cubies. There, it's face cubies. So see those faces of those little cubes? Well, the sticker, there's 1 sticker. There's another sticker here right opposite. those belong together, they basically form one hypercube, face hypercube. Now we've got three sticker pieces. They're in the corner here, they're on the edges here. So see those three cubical stickers, they belong together. As you manipulate the cube, they will always stay together. Right? They can never be separated. They form one hypercube. And then we've got one more type of hypercube. These are the corner hypercubes, and they have four stickers. And you can see them here highlighted. Now, hypertwists. As I said, there's a lot more complicated twists here in this puzzle than in the ordinary Rubik's Cube. You click on any one of the stickers here and the program will perform a twist. So let's just do this. So for example, on that corner here, we get a corner twist. Right? So basically we are turning around the diagonal that goes through this corner. Now here, that's an edge twist. And then we've got one more kind of twist, that's a face twist. So there's the first very important feature of this puzzle that I have to draw your attention to, and that is that every single twist can be replaced by face twist. So you can really restrict yourself to face twist. Just to show you what I mean by this, let's just focus on one of those corner twists. Okay, so there it is. And now I'll undo this corner twist by just doing face twists. So one, and there is another one, actually just two face twists can replace one of those corner twists. Also edge twists, here we go, there it is. I'll undo this with face twists. So there, and there. Okay, so what that means for you, if you start solving a Rubik's Cube, you actually don't have to worry about the fancy corner twists and the edge twists. You can just stick with face twists. So now let's see where those 3D cubes are hiding inside the 4D cube and how we can use them to solve the 4D cube. Now, anybody who knows anything about cubes, and I hope you belong in this category, knows that you need just a few algorithms to solve the whole cube. In fact, four is enough. So you need like one algorithm to cycle three edges of the Rubik's Cube. Then there's another one here, one that cycles three corners. And then there's one that just flips two edges. And then there's one that twists two corners. So you use those sort of algorithms here to put the individual cubes in the right place. And then you use those algorithms to orient them. And what I want to show you is how you can translate those algorithms into algorithms for the 4D Rubik's Cube. So for that, we'll first find some Rubik's Cubes in the 4D one. So here we go. So it's just a different way of looking at the 4D Rubik's Cube. And here actually, when you kind of pull things together like this, what we're actually looking at usually is kind of an exploded view, is just a Rubik's Cube. So for example, click on that face here, you know, just the usual twist. Of course, the 4D Rubik's Cube is also twisted in this case. Now what I do here is I'm actually executing one of those algorithms, 3D Rubik's Cube algorithms on it. It was the one that flips edges. And let's just see what effect it had on the 4D Rubik's Cube. Okay, so we kind of expand things back out again. And you can see very few hypercubes of the 4D Rubik's Cube are affected by this. In fact, it's just like two columns of hypercubes. And every single one of the hypercubes in there is still in the same place as before. It's just that the two stickers have swapped over. Now, what I like to do is actually I like to focus on the middle of the puzzle, do my surgery there, and then rotate things in and out from the outside. So I'm going to change this new algorithm into one that actually affects the middle by just rotating things down to the middle like this. And so there you can see the columns of hypercubes that are being affected right in the middle now. Now let's do the same sort of thing for another one of our 3D Rubik's Cube algorithms, the one that cycles edges. It's actually quite impressive when you see that thing in action. So that's again just a 3D Rubik's Cube algorithm. What do we get? Well, again, there's just three columns of hypercubes that are being affected, and actually they just get cycled around like this. And if you just look at what we've done now, that already looks very promising. In fact, when you look at it more closely, you see that these columns that we're talking about here contain one face hypercube each. So what gets cycled here in particular is three face hypercubes, and here, again, every column has one of those face hypercubes in it, these get flipped. So what you can do is you can use these algorithms actually to fix up all the positions and orientations of the face hypercube straight away. You just kind of go for it and you don't worry about the other bits that get pushed around here, which is all edge hypercubes. The second trick now, which makes things very clean, okay? So what I want to do is, I want to have another look at this algorithm and just refine it a little bit so that I get out a cycle of just edge pieces, edge hypercubes. Let's just look. So what I want is something like this. So this edge hypercube, that one, and that one. Just those cycled around with nothing else going on. And we do this with commutators. And if you watch my other Rubik's Cube video, you're familiar with it. Otherwise, maybe watch it. So what we'll do is, we'll just twist the top. So we just press this sticker. That will rotate things. Some bits are left in peace. Now comes the thing. I'm going to run this 3D Rubik's Cube algorithm in reverse. It's going to restore all the pieces that I've not rotated away to where they were before. Okay, so let's just do this. So this one here in reverse, let's go for it. And you can already see that looks a lot cleaner. And now the only thing that I need to do is untwist the top, which I'll do. And you see the overall effect this has is that it just cycles these three edge pieces around. So that's very clean, right? A very clean solution. And well, it gets us something different too. We can just go back to this column look, and I can also isolate a cycle of face pieces, a very clean cycle of face pieces. And the way I do this is I do a slice move, which this program can also do. It's just like with a Rubik's Cube, where you kind of just take the middle slice and do it like this. So I've just sliced away the middle, and now I'm going to run this guy in reverse. It's going to restore everything else. Okay. It's a bit of magic, really. Okay, let's wait for it. Okay, so it looks very good. Now unslice the middle and just have a really, really close look at it. And what you get is a clean three cycle here that just affects those face pieces. And now we do the same for all the other 3D algorithms. In total, we get out of this 8 algorithms for the 4D Rubik's Cube and for all the different hypercubes. So we've got algorithms for positioning the face hypercubes and for orienting them. We've got algorithms for the edge hypercubes, and we've got algorithms for the corner hypercubes. And actually here in the middle you see we've got actually lots of algorithms for the edges. And it seems that we're doubling up things here. So we've got two algorithms for cycling edges, but they're actually doing slightly different things. So when you create them, create both of them. Okay, so now how do we use these algorithms to solve the 4D Rubik's Cube? Well, you can just kind of go for it. In fact, you can go for any of the different sorts of pieces straight away, because all those algorithms that we've created work on the different hypercubes in isolation. So you could either go straight for the corners or for the edges or for the faces. Well, I recommend you go for the face hypercubes because they only have two stickers. And here are, you know, the stickers highlighted where they belong. They're also fairly easy to locate. So for example, if we look at the cell here in the middle, there's going to be sticker of a certain color. In this case, it's some sort of blue. And in this guy here, sticker of another color, a purple. So we know that this face hypercube that goes here has to have a blue and a purple sticker. Okay, so pretty easy. So let's go for it. And also, this way, it's very easy to kind of get used to the interface and how this thing moves and all that. So you're finished with that. At some point in time, you move on to the edge pieces. Those have three stickers, a little bit harder to orient. Also, so far, it seems like we only need those 3D Rubik's Cube algorithms to do the whole thing. But actually here at this point, we encounter a surprise. Something works for the 4D Rubik's Cube that does not work for the 3D Rubik's Cube. On a 3D Rubik's Cube, you can never twist a corner in isolation. You can never flip an edge in isolation. Anybody who knows anything knows this. With a 4D Rubik's Cube, that's possible. So you can have something like this happening. So the whole 4D Rubik's Cube is solved except for one of the edge hypercubes. It's in the right place, but the stickers are cycled around. It's twisted around. In fact, all 6 permutations of those 3 stickers are possible. That comes as a little bit of a surprise, and you actually need a separate algorithm to take care of that. And what I've done is I've actually created a second video for all those people who really want to tackle this thing. And in that video, I describe the interface that you're dealing with, how to create log files, how to create macros, how to, you know, create those algorithms. Eventually, hopefully, you get to fixing up all the edges. And then, well, only the corners remain. And with the corners, a similar kind of surprise waits for you at the end. You may have solved the whole Rubik's Cube, and the only thing left over is this one corner hypercube. Here, the stickers have been permuted around. So you also need another algorithm to take care of that. Okay, what's next? So you've solved your 40 Rubik's Cube. What else can you do? Well, scramble it up again. Like so. And now try to blind solve it. So how does that work? Well, you've got it scrambled here. You can look at it as long as you want. Then you put on your blindfold and type on a key. No, it's not going to work. So they've got an alternative setup for this. What you do is you gray out what you see here. And now you try to solve this thing from memory. And once you think it's all in place, you ungray. And if the thing looks like this, then you've done something that nobody else has been able to do so far. Blind solve a 40 Rubik's Cube. One person has been able to do the 2x2x2x2. Nobody has been able to do this one. Something slightly less challenging, quite a few people have been able to do this, is do the 4x4x4x4. Looks like this. Or, well, nobody's done that one. Bit tedious, I suspect. The 9x9x9x9. Or, you could try this one here, which is the 5-dimensional Rubik's Cube. Or if that's not insane enough, you could try this one here, which is the 4-dimensional counterpart of the Megaminx. 120 colors. Some people have done this. Crazy. Okay, but now here's the real challenge. Okay, here's the real challenge. And I really want as many people as possible to go for this challenge. Solve the 40 Rubik's Cube and get yourself into the Hall of Fame. So the people who maintain the program also maintain a Hall of Fame. And everybody who solves the Rubik's Cube can send in their log file and have their name recorded in the Hall of Fame. So Hall of Fame starts in 1988, and it's a fairly short list considering the time. So it ends at 230, and that's actually me here, last entry, on the 27th of May, 2016. Anything will count. As long as you get to the end, you'll get the Mathologer seal of approval, and it will be a very remarkable achievement.